Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Tulip Shirt Murders by Heather Weidner, narrated by Tara Marie Kirk. Prologue. Delanie Fitzgerald hopped on the stool at Lucille's lounge to get a better view of the guy she tailed. He leaned forward, inching closer to a raven-haired woman at the end of the bar. Delanie ordered a ginger ale and straightened her lycra dress. The glances from the other male patrons let her know that it was the perfect outfit for this evening. The man looked past his companion and stared at Delanie, who smiled and tossed her red curls over her shoulder. She sipped her drink and waited. The dark-haired woman moved on to talk to two guys at the pool table. The man picked up his drink and slid into the empty seat next to Delanie. That didn't take long, she thought.
Hey there,
he said, moving in closer and brushing her shoulder with his. Hi, she said as she pressed her lips together in a half smile.
I haven't seen you in here before.
I'm new in town, and this looked like a fun place to spend a Saturday night. I didn't want to stay home by myself.
It's a friendly place,
he said, signaling the bartender for a refill. I'll be back in just a minute. Don't go anywhere, and save my seat, she said, winking at the 40-ish man next to her.
Hurry back,
he said, leaning toward her. A few minutes later, she pulled her bar stool back. Did you miss me? A full drink greeted her on her return.
Most certainly,
he said, scooting his bar stool closer to hers. Thanks for the refill. I didn't catch your name.
It's Joey.
Well, hello, Joey. I'm Misty, she said, sticking two fingers into her glass. When she pulled her hand back, the pearly white nail polish turned purple. She smiled and pretended to take a sip. So, Joey, what do folks do for excitement around here in Mechanicsville? I've only been here a month or so, and I need some ideas for fun. He leaned toward her again. Any closer, and he'd be sitting in her lap.
I like to have a good time. We could go somewhere quiet and have our own party. And we could talk about other things we could do next weekend.
We could, but we just met, she said, batting her false eyelashes.
Ask anything you want. I'm an open book.
Noticing the indent on his ring finger, Delanie/Misty smiled. No wife or girlfriend waiting for you?
No, it's just me. Any misters in your life?
Nope, she said, licking her lips. What do you do?
I'm a counselor,
he said, looking over his shoulder. Before he could ask about her job, Delanie grabbed her drink and let it slide out of her hand. Most of it landed in Joey's lap. He jumped up, sopping up the liquid with several cocktail napkins. Oh, Joey, I'm so sorry, she said with her pouty lips. It was damp and it just slipped. When he didn't say anything, she continued. Let's get out of here. We'll go somewhere where you can get out of those wet clothes. He dropped a 20 and the balled up napkins on the bar and rushed her to the front door. He pushed the glass door open and she said, I'm over there. She pointed to the black Mustang. How about I follow you to your favorite spot?
Okay, I'm in that white accent.
Delanie slid in her car and locked the doors. She put her purse with its hidden camera on the dash. She followed Joey to a roach motel and made sure the camera caught him going in to register with that huge wet spot on his jeans. When he was engrossed in a conversation with the desk clerk, she backed out of the parking lot and floored it toward the interstate. She would gladly turn over all the goods on the Reverend Joseph Milton, especially after he slipped something in her drink. Her first task tomorrow would be to complete her report for her client, the Southern Oak Avenue Church Council. They suspected their assistant pastor had a secret life, and Delanie had the proof for them. Case closed on another Saturday night of pretend dating. Chapter 1. Delanie hip-checked the door to her car and smiled as she glanced back. The fortune cookie she'd had with yesterday's lunch predicted an exciting future. Maybe today. She grabbed the mail from Saturday and headed inside the dark office suite. Dunk! Hey, Duncan! She yelled as she locked the front door behind her. A muffled, "We're back here," came a voice from somewhere inside. She followed the voice to the kitchenette, part of the two office suite and conference room she shared with her partner, Duncan Reynolds, and his English bulldog, Margaret. Duncan supplemented his PI income with computer work. He referred to himself as a computer geek, his euphemism for a hacker. Delanie looked the other way and never asked about his sources, because he was a wizard at getting computers to cough up information. "Hey, what's up?" she asked.
"Breakfast. Want some?"
he asked as he closed the microwave door and pressed several buttons. "It's almost lunchtime. What is it?"
"A bagel sandwich made with jalapenos, some leftover fish sticks, and bacon. Oh, and some cheese."
"No thanks," she said, hoping Duncan didn't see her wrinkle her nose. Fast approaching 40, Delanie and Duncan still had teenage junk food habits. But sometimes Duncan's food concoctions surprised Delanie.
"I'm trying to add more protein to my morning diet," he said as he joined her at the table.
Margaret, the brown and white log with legs, positioned herself under his chair to ensure she got any scraps that hit the floor. She smiled.
"I finished the Swinging Reverend case on Saturday night, and I emailed my report to the church council yesterday. What's new with you? I haven't seen you in a couple of days."
"I've been working on a website for a deli. Oh, we got a call this morning from a music producer about a job. He wants to avail himself of our investigative talents. He thinks he's being bootlegged."
"Interesting. Did he hear about us?"
"Our fabulous website," he said, winking.
She smiled again. "I'm going to check email. We'll call him when you're done eating," Delanie said.
"I'm done,"
he said, handing the last bite to Margaret and wiping his hands on his jeans. The computer whiz and his four-legged sidekick followed Delanie down the hall to her office. Duncan plopped down in her guest chair and flipped open his laptop. He jotted a phone number on a post-it.
"Here, ask for Ian Barnes. He's the head honcho of marketing."
Duncan's voice trailed off as Delanie pushed the speakerphone button and punched in the number. After three rings, a female voice said,
"It's a good day at RVA Recordings. How may I help you?"
"I'm returning Ian Barnes' call," Delanie said.
After a, "One moment, please," a montage of on-hold music blared through the speaker.
"Barnes here."
"Mr. Barnes, this is Delanie Fitzgerald and Duncan Reynolds from Falcon Investigations. You called earlier about our services."
"Yes. I'd like you all to come out and talk with us about some issues we're having with our CDs from some of our artists. Can we meet tomorrow around 3? We're on Broad Street across from the Science Museum."
After a pause, she heard,
"I look forward to talking with you."
"And we look forward to meeting you tomorrow at 3 works," Delanie said.
"Sounds good,"
he said before the line went dead.
"Are you available tomorrow?" Delanie asked Duncan.
"I'm working on a website for my client who owns a deli and wine shop. I'd rather focus my attention there if you don't mind. Do you really need me?"
"I always need you, but I can meet with them and take notes. Fill me in on what you know about Mr. Barnes's company."
"RVA Recordings is a small company based here in Richmond. Its bread and butter is bluegrass, country, and gospel, but they've recently created an R&B and rap offshoot. They rent studio time if you want to record your own music or create radio ads. and they have a pretty nice website.
Anybody famous come out of their operation?
I'm sure they're probably popular and maybe even famous in bluegrass and gospel circles, but I don't recognize any of them. The website touts Doc Sutton, Hazel Crow, and Sam Hartland as part of their operation. Hey, look, on some Friday nights they have jam sessions. Guests can bring instruments and play or hang out and listen.
I'll check it out and let you know what I find. I forgot to tell you, I saw a banged-up Honda Civic on Craigslist for $1,500. I'm going to go look at it. After that idiot vandalized my car last summer, I was thinking about getting a beater for stakeouts.
You sure it's worth what he's asking?
I think so. I looked at the Carfax and called my brother Robbie last night. The car doesn't look great, but it's old and gray. It would blend in when I want to spy. And it wouldn't be too conspicuous in most neighborhoods. I need something other than the Mustang some days.
If you want a second car, that'd probably work. It's nondescript.
Dunk, if I buy it, I'll need a ride. Would you be able to take a break and drive me over this afternoon to look at it?
Give me about an hour to finish some things,
he said as he stepped into the hallway. Margaret waddled out after her best friend.
Thanks,
she said to her empty office. An hour later, Duncan pulled his Camaro into the Walmart parking lot in Chester. The guy said to meet him in the row closest to the main road, she said.
I don't see a gray car, but we can wait here a bit,
he said, pulling out his laptop. Margaret snored loudly from the back seat. Delanie got out of the car to watch for the seller. A Honda Civic with the radio blaring, followed by a blue minivan, eventually pulled in beside Duncan's Tweety Bird-colored Camaro. A thin guy jumped out of the car. The woman in the driver's seat of the van sat ramrod straight with both hands on the wheel and kept the engine running. Delanie thought it odd that she stared forward and never turned her head. The man said,
Delanie, I'm Dan Taylor.
Thanks for meeting me, Dan. This is Duncan, my partner. Dan nodded, and Delanie continued. And that is?
My wife, Sandy.
After a long pause, Delanie asked, Do you mind if I drive it around the lot? She looked the car over, but refrained from kicking the tires. It looked okay for an older car. She'd have to see how it rides.
Okay. The window on the passenger side sticks a little bit, but if you pull on it when you push the button, it eventually goes up,
he said. Not a problem, she said, sliding into the driver's seat. She adjusted the rearview mirror and the seat. After a quick lap around the parking lot, she stopped beside the minivan. The woman looked at her phone and paid no attention to anything around her. Is your wife okay? She asked.
Yep,
Dan Taylor said.
She's not too happy about me selling the car to get a motorcycle.
Delanie climbed out and looked under the car. She opened both doors, the hood, and the trunk.
It looks good to me. Will you take $1,200 for it?
How about $13, and you can drive away with it today.
Let's split it at $1,250, and I'll take it off your hands.
Deal,
he said, shaking her hand. After he passed her the signed title, Delanie waved to Dan Taylor as he clambered into the minivan that his wife had already started backing out of the space. Duncan rolled down the window, and Margaret climbed onto Duncan's lap and stuck her ample head out the window. Delanie didn't lean in too closely. Margaret was the slobber queen with a 3-foot tongue.
Well, it's all mine,
and if you're nice, I'll let you borrow it.
Lucky me,
he said.
Do you want me to follow you back to the office?
Might not be a bad idea in case it's jinxed. I think I'll leave this in the alley. You can use it if you need to.
See you back at the ranch,
he said, rolling up the window. The next day, Delanie crossed the Powhite Parkway Bridge. She admired the river and the clear autumn sky, punctuated with puffy clouds.
A freight train inched along on another bridge on its way to the Yucca train yard. She switched lanes and exited the highway, where she found the recording studio across the street from the Science Museum. A small bell tinkled when she pulled open the glass door, triggering the receptionist's wave. The receptionist twanged. "Thanks for calling. I'll let him know." She hung up the phone and smiled. "I'm Delanie Fitzgerald. I'm here to see Ian Barnes."
"Hi, he's expecting you. Have a seat, and I'll let him know you're here,"
said the woman behind the desk, who resembled a Disney pixie. "Thanks," Delanie said, sinking down in the modern blob of a chair in the small reception area. Before she could get comfortable, the receptionist returned.
"He's in the conference room, if you'll follow me."
Delanie trailed her down a long hallway lined with framed photos of musicians and bands. She didn't recognize any of the names or faces. The receptionist pulled open the glass door and ushered her in. Two men lounged in leather chairs watching a rap video on the big screen that spanned the back wall. The rest of the room boasted a lot of glass and chrome, accented with swirls of light blues and browns. The man in jeans and a khaki shirt stood, muting the sound.
"Hi, Delanie. I'm Ian Barnes. This is Tim Peters, my attorney."
He pointed to the other man in a tailored suit and expensive-looking shoes.
"Thanks for coming down. Have a seat. Would you like something to drink?"
he asked.
"No, I'm fine, Mr. Barnes," Delanie said, as the receptionist backed out and pulled the door closed. Sliding her chair to the teak conference table, Delanie opened her portfolio and readied herself to take notes.
"Call me Ian. I'm not sure how much you know about us," he said. "We're a boutique studio that my dad and uncle started about 50 years ago. Since then, we've added other genres and do some voiceovers for local radio and TV commercials."
"And how can Falcon Investigations help you?" The attorney cleared his throat and shifted in his seat.
"Ms. Fitzgerald, we have it on good authority that some of our recordings have been turning up in area flea markets and other locations. The only problem is there are more CDs and DVDs on the streets than what RVA Recordings licensed. We would like your firm to investigate this for us, so Ian can protect his investment."
"I'm sure we can help you. This is Falcon Investigation's fee structure, and this is our standard contract," she said, pushing the papers across the table. "After we take care of the administrative items, my partner and I can begin our research. Where have the CDs turned up?"
"Local flea markets and at a couple of music festivals," Ian said. "One of our bands reported seeing a guy selling them out of a truck at Cousin Billy's Bluegrass Jamboree last month."
"Do you have a phone number for the witness?"
"I do, and I think one of the guys in the band got a photo of the truck. I'll check."
The lawyer scanned Delanie's documents and then slid the contract in his briefcase.
"I'll have this faxed to you."
"My partner, Duncan, and I will get started as soon as we have a ratified contract. Any ideas or guesses about the bootlegging?"
"No, not really. It's definitely not our downloads. It's only happening with the physical media. It seems to be across our entire portfolio, and not just with our A-list artists. Please, copy Tim on everything," Ian said, picking up his phone and tapping a message. Tim Peters pushed a business card toward Delanie.
"Will do," she said.
"Would you like a quick tour of our place before you go?"
Ian asked, rising. Delanie nodded, and the lawyer said,
"I'm going to head back to the office. We'll talk next week."
The record producer rose and shook hands with his lawyer. Ian led Delanie down another hallway lined with more headshots and several gold records. At the end of the narrow walkway, he pushed open a door. A technician with headphones watched a bank of dials on his laptop. On the other side of the large picture window,
A bluegrass trio played in a room covered with white acoustic tiles. A variety of instruments and microphone stands lined the perimeter of the room. It was more nondescript and utilitarian than what Delanie imagined for a recording studio.
Jordan here makes sure everything is right in our recording studios. All the rooms are soundproofed, but he can see and hear everything. He's got one eye on the performers and the other on his computer.
The other man nodded, but kept looking forward at the trio. Another young woman stepped in and handed the music producer a folder.
Thanks, Kelly. Here are marketing materials and contact information for you,
he said, handing the packet to Delanie. Through the glass, they watched the trio warm up and launch into a song. After two takes of a song, Ian said,
Let me know what you uncover. I want to get these jerks. They're ripping off the musicians and my company.
I'll be in touch in a few days, she said. My partner and I will do an in-depth investigation and send you a report of our findings. On the ride back to the office, Delanie called Duncan. After his quirky voicemail message, she said,
Hey, Dunk. I met with Ian Barnes and his attorney. We should have a ratified contract later this week, but we can go ahead and get started with the research on the counterfeit CDs. And when I see you next, could you look at the Honda with me? I drove it around last night, and I heard a kerthunking sound coming from the back.
Chapter 2 Delanie flipped on the coffee maker and escaped to her office to make a call. Three rings later, she heard, Thanks for calling Butterfly Blue.
Hi, Robin. I need to ask you a favor. Can I bribe you with lunch and a trade for some information? I need to tap into your flea market knowledge.
Delanie and Robin Kirby had been friends since economics class at Virginia Commonwealth University. Sure. I'm knee-deep in some refinishing projects for a client, but if you don't mind eating in the workroom, you could bring lunch today or tomorrow. We need to catch up. It's been too long.
Okay, I'll bring food. Is 1:30 today okay?
That works. I should be at a good stopping point. See you then. Before she could move on to her email, Delanie heard the back door slam. Moments later, Duncan wandered in with Margaret at his heels.
What's up?
You would have liked the tour of the recording studio. They had all kinds of gadgets and computers. I watched a bluegrass band record some tracks, and I met Ian Barnes and his lawyer. They believe the company's CDs are being bootlegged and sold at flea markets. He also gave me the contact information for the band who spotted the hot items at a festival.
Interesting, he said. We'll figure out who's copying their stuff. I'm surprised that they're still selling CDs. It must be to an older audience.
I'm going to talk to my friend Robin at lunch. She used to sell her furniture at local flea markets, and I was hoping she could give me an insider's view of what was going on.
Give me what you have from the studio, and I'll do some research. What's wrong with your new car?
Oh, right. When I drove it back to the office, there was a weird noise in the back. It drove okay. And before you ask, there were no warning lights. It sounded like something rolling around. I checked the trunk, but didn't see anything.
Let's go take a look.
Duncan drove Margaret around the parking lot several times in the Civic. He parked, climbed out, and crawled under the back of the car. Delanie sat down on the back steps, and Margaret plopped down on her feet to await the verdict. He slid out and popped the trunk. He poked and prodded and pulled up the flooring.
I think I found it,
he said, moving the jack.
What?
She asked, jumping up to see what was inside. Margaret glared at her for disturbing her resting spot.
There's a vase back here in the wheel well.
Uh-oh, Delanie said. That's not a vase. That's an urn.
What's the difference?
The lid. Vases usually don't have sealed tops.
Looks like you got something extra with your used car. You've been driving around with someone's Aunt Clara or Uncle Clem.
Who would leave that in a car? Or who would carry an urn around in the trunk? That's a little creepy.
People leave all kinds of things in their cars. Look, there's a funeral home plaque with a serial number on the base. You call the previous owner, and if it's not his, I'll see what I can find from this,
he said, closing the trunk. Delanie dialed the cellar. Duncan took the urn inside, and Margaret followed close behind her guy.
Hi, Dan. This is Delanie Fitzgerald. I bought the Honda Civic from you this week. I found something curious in the trunk, and I wanted to see if it was yours.
If it's not legal, it's not mine.
No, nothing like that. I heard a thunking noise and found an urn in the wheel well. I wanted to return it to the family.
Did you say urn? Like with ashes?
I guess there are ashes. I didn't open it.
It's not ours,
he said, hanging up.
Well, that was weird, Delanie muttered. Dan Taylor's behavior was as odd as his wife's had been during the test drive.
She found Duncan with his feet propped up on his desk. The urn, with a baseball cap perched on top, rested on the credenza.
What's that all about?
She asked, pointing to the newly decorated urn.
I'm calling him Bruce. He seemed like a Nationals fan. I thought he needed some personality. Any luck with the previous owner?
Nope. The car guy asked if what I found was illegal. Then he said the urn wasn't theirs and hung up.
Well, leave Bruce here. I'll do some research. He has to belong to someone. Margaret and I are on the case.
Delanie rolled her eyes and left for her meeting with Robin. After a quick stop for salads, Delanie parked in front of her friend's shop, which was bookended by a cell phone store and a smoothie shop in an older strip mall. Filled with all kinds of brightly painted furniture and accessories, Robin's store reminded Delanie of the tropics. A tuxedo cat, curled up on a tasseled pillow in an orange side chair, guarded the front lobby. His eyes followed her as she moved across the room.
Robin? Hey, Robin, it's Delanie, she called.
Be up in a minute, came from the back area. The cat raised its head, yawned, and returned to its napping spot. Robin came through the swinging doors, wiping her hands on a rag.
Hey, girl, it's good to see you. My sister's at a doctor's appointment. She usually works the front counter. Thanks for bringing lunch.
Robin had her long brown hair pulled up in a twist, though several tendrils had escaped and curled around her oval face. Pastel-colored paint splatters covered her sweatshirt and jeans.
Your store is lovely, and your friend here is a good greeter, Delanie said, scratching the cat's head.
That's Penguin, my guard cat. I got custody of him after the divorce. Come on back, and I'll show you what I'm working on. I love that I now have a work area back here. I don't have to tear down furniture in my dining room anymore.
Wow, you've got all kinds of things going on, said Delanie.
She handed her friend a bag. I'm painting a children's bedroom set for a little princess. Pink and purple with lots of polka dots are the order of the day. I love doing kids' projects.
How fun. Thanks for letting me pick your brain. Here's the deal. I have a client who thinks some of his merchandise is being counterfeited and sold at flea markets. What can you tell me about the flea markets in the area? Any rules or expectations I need to be aware of?
Robin cleared an area on her desk and drug a guest chair over for Delanie. The two women dug into their salads. After finishing a bite, Robin said,
Well, when you get a booth, you sign something stating that you're not selling any illegal or stolen items, but no one really does a lot of checking.
I don't ever remember anyone asking about my wares. Anyway, you'll see all kinds of stuff. I wondered sometimes if some of the merchandise fell off a truck somewhere.
After pausing for another bite, she continued.
There are a few fleas close to us. The old drive-in on Jefferson Davis Highway is an outdoor one called the Big Flea. Some of the sellers are private individuals, but most are pros who are there every weekend. Then there's another indoor one up Jeff Davis on the Chesterfield County side called Bev's Collectibles. Oh, and then there's one on the way to Amelia County. It's in a field next to a truck stop. The owner's wife rents spots by the day on Saturdays. I'm not sure if that one has a name. It's next to CJ's truck stop. There is one in Hanover, too. And there's a really big one off I-95 near Fredericksburg.
So what do the ones on this side of town sell?
They have anything you can imagine. When I had a booth, I was usually in the back with the other furniture vendors, but they have everything from clothes and appliances to sports memorabilia. You'd be surprised at what you find there.
Do all of them cater to the same level of clientele? Asked Delanie.
Sort of. Bev's tries to be more upscale. It's billed as antiques and collectibles. It's a lot of booths in an old department store. The drive-in one is outside and filled mostly with dealers trying to make a living. If you're looking for bargain basement prices, you won't find them at the ones on Jeff Davis. And if you hang around long enough, you'll start to recognize the regular vendors. The one out in Amelia County is more like a yard sale.
Any words of warning before I go and visit? Delanie asked as she wadded up her napkin.
If you're buying, be aware of what you're getting and what you're paying. You could get soaked on the memorabilia stuff. There's also a lot of junk passed off as antiques. And if it's a collectible, make sure it has provenance with it. Sometimes there are autographs that don't have any documentation. Lots of fake autographs are out there floating around at sales and on the internet.
You sold at that one?
At the Big Flea, and sometimes at the one in Amelia. I used to have a booth at another one on Hull Street, but it closed a few years back. I get most of my stuff at yard sales and auctions. The prices are better. Hey, I'm going to a storage auction in a few weeks. Wanna go?
That sounds like fun. I like to see what people save and pack away. And it will be fun to hang out with you.
Good. I'll text you the information. Enough about work stuff. So, what's new with you? Dating anyone interesting?
Details. I want details. Sadly, there's not much to tell. I dated this guy from Amelia County last summer, but he turned out to be a less than sterling Prince Charming with a huge fear of commitment. C'est la vie. He's out of the picture. It's been all work lately. What about you?
The store and my projects keep me busy. Right now, Penguin is the only man in my life, and I like it that way.
I love what you've done here. Thanks so much for letting me drop in. I appreciate all the insight on the flea market world. I think I'm going to visit some this week.
Good luck with your investigation,
Robin said as she moved her drop cloth and picked up a wooden paintbrush.
I'll text you about the auction.
Delanie hugged her friend.
Outside, Delanie fired up the Mustang and checked her phone. Finding a call me as soon as you can message from Duncan, she told the car to call his cell.
Hey, I think I solved your problem, he said.
Which one? She asked, making a right turn. Ignoring her comment, he replied,
I called a guy I know at Barlow's funeral home. My buddy Harold traced the serial number on Owen's urn. He located what's left of the family.
Okay, but who's Owen?
Harold said the ashes are a Mr. Owen Bozeman's. There are some distant relatives in Lynchburg. I looked up the history on the car. It was owned by a Sharon Bozeman Todd about 10 years ago. I guess she put the urn in the trunk and forgot about it when the car sold.
That's really sad, she said. It's also unusual that the last owner didn't notice the sound coming from the trunk.
Yep, he probably had the radio cranked up all the time. But at least we know who the urn belongs to. And we solved the mystery of the noise in the trunk. Be grateful that it wasn't the car acting up already. Margaret and I are going out for late lunch. We'll drop the urn off at Harold's place. He'll make sure Owen gets back to Lynchburg.
Glad that she didn't have to worry about the noise in the trunk or the urn anymore, Delanie poked around on the internet looking for used CDs on Craigslist and other local for sale sites.
not having much luck, she switched her search to area flea markets, which turned into perusing Facebook. Hours later, she closed the laptop and decided a visit to the big flea would be her best chance to find a lead on the RVA Recordings bootleg CDs. Chapter 3. The next Saturday, Delanie closed Duncan's car door and adjusted her black ball cap with the hidden video camera while he pulled out Margaret's pet stroller from the car's trunk. Smaller than one for a baby, the pet model had a black mesh covering. Duncan clicked her leash to the handle and got her settled in for another mid-morning nap. Walking the length of the flea market would have been more exercise than Margaret did in a month. Delanie paid their admission, and they wandered up and down the rows of tables and temporary displays. Sports memorabilia and, as seen on TV items, seemed to be everywhere. At a table covered with sports jerseys and hats, a large man with a bushy beard asked,
"What's your favorite baseball team?"
"The Nats." "Hey, you've got quite a collection here," Delanie said as she picked up a red ball cap and pretended to look at the price. "Actually, I was looking for CDs and DVDs. I was hoping to find some old stuff. Do you have anything like that?" She put the cap down in front of a stack that sported logos for the New York Yankees.
"Nope, but you might want to try a couple of aisles over. The techno media stuff is over there," he said, pointing over his shoulder. "But I've got jerseys and hats if you change your mind. Plus, I'm more fun than the guys over there."
She smiled. Delanie jogged to catch up with Duncan and Margaret, who were already halfway down the next row. On aisle D, they struck gold when they found electronics, speakers, and cell phones lining each booth. Midway down on the left, Delanie spotted a display with boxes of CDs. She reached up and pushed the button on her cap to start recording. At the first table, she spotted used CDs of songs from the 70s and 80s. Moving on, she zeroed in on another booth across the aisle. Stacked boxes and bins outlined the perimeter of the booth and made a short wall around the tables. Turning her head slightly to pan the entire area, Delanie pointed the brim at the two men dressed in jeans and camo t-shirts. They hadn't shaved in days. Differing only in height, they shared the same square jaw and receding hairline. The larger of the two asked,
"Can we help you find anything?"
"Hi," said Delanie as Duncan and Margaret strolled ahead. "I'm looking for CDs and DVDs. You have a good selection. Do you mind if I have a look?"
"No,"
said the shorter one, who sounded like he had a wad of something in his mouth.
"Help yourself."
"Any Elvis or Johnny Cash?" she asked.
"I don't think so,"
said the other guy, who could have been a linebacker.
"We might have some country in this box."
Delanie browsed through several bins and recorded the inventory with her hidden camera. Bingo! She recognized some of the bands from the material Ian Barnes provided. None of the CDs had any branding for RVA Recordings on them. When she explored further, it looked like the covers were printed on low-quality paper by an inkjet printer. "How much for these?" she asked, fingering the paper insert. The ink rubbed off on her hands.
"7 apiece or 2 for $10.
"I'll take these 4, she said, handing the short guy with sideburns a 20. He pushed the 4 CDs across the table. "Do you have a bag?"
No, said the bigger guy. "But thanks for your business."
She dropped the CDs in her purse. "Oh, by the way, I have a website where I sell stuff. Do you have a card or number where I could contact you in case I wanted to buy more? Do you guys ever sell in bulk?"
"Maybe," said the big guy. "We don't have a website, but here's my cell phone number. We might be able to work something out."
He jotted his number on the back of a crumpled receipt he pulled from his pocket. "Thanks," she said, taking the slip of paper. Flipping over the fast food receipt, she saw a handwritten Frank and his cell phone number. "Hi, Frank. I'm Christy. The tall one nodded, and the men returned to their conversation. Delanie left and caught up to Duncan and Margaret at a nearby booth with a display of laptops and computer gadgets.
Hey,
Duncan said.
He's got routers and blades.
Delanie didn't see any knives, so she guessed he was interested in something geeky. Okay, good. I bought some CDs. I'm gonna walk down this way. Are you getting hungry? We can stop by the snack bar or grab something on the way back.
Let's keep looking to see what else we can find. We can do lunch later, he said.
They strolled through the former drive-in movie theater for about an hour without seeing any more CDs. Back on the housewares aisle, a large mirror caught Delaney's eye. It would be perfect in her living room. How much for the oval mirror? She asked a lady with long blonde hair styled like Marcia Brady.
200.
Would you take 80?
150 is as low as I could go,
said the woman, swatting at a fly buzzing in front of her. Before Delanie could decide, she heard a guttural growl from Margaret's stroller. Looking around, she spotted a fat tabby curled up in a nearby chair. Margaret barked and jumped around in the dog stroller. It lurched forward and tipped, dumping the dog on the asphalt. The cat screeched and darted through the booth. Margaret woofed several times. Before Duncan could react, she took off after the cat, dragging her tipped stroller behind her. Duncan raced after the menagerie. Delanie had never seen Margaret, or Duncan for that matter, move so fast. People screamed and swatted at the cat, dog, and the black stroller. Duncan caught up with Margaret two aisles over. After some mild scolding and lots of babying, he put Margaret back in the stroller. Delanie paid for a few broken items, and they walked purposefully to the front gate. The cat disappeared into the crowd. After closing the car door, Duncan asked,
"Did you get that recorded?"
Delanie nodded and turned the hat camera off. "I forgot to turn it off after the CD booth. It should be fun to watch you all in action."
"Margaret wasn't playing with that cat. The chase was on. Let's head back to the office to see what you captured on the recording."
After a quick stop at Taco Bell, they settled in the conference room to watch the chase video. Duncan skipped ahead to Margaret's romp after the cat. After watching it twice, Delanie suppressed a fit of giggles and asked, "Okay, what did we get on the two bubbas at the CD booth?"
"Wait a second. I'm posting the Margaret clip on YouTube. Don't worry, no one will be able to trace it back to us. I deleted the GPS and routed it through several different IP addresses. It'll go viral."
Delanie shrugged at his geek speak. "I'm surprised there wasn't major damage from the cat chase. The broken vase and lamp totaled about $20. And I'm glad none of that happened near the CD vendors. I may have to go back for another visit. I'm pretty sure we're interested in those two guys. I recognize some of the bands from Ian's marketing stuff."
"Thanks for covering the cost of the broken stuff while I was tending to Margaret. I'll buy you lunch this week."
"No problem," she said.
"Give me the guy's cell phone number. I'll see what I can find on him," Duncan said.
"What do we know from all of your secret sources?" Delanie asked impatiently after Duncan had been clicking for only seconds.
"Hold your horses. The internet may move that fast, but I don't."
He clicked several keys and started a search on one of his dark websites.
"Here, the cell phone's registered to a Frank Emerson. He's 33 and lives on Branders Bridge Road in Chester. Let me see what I can find on the address."
After a pause, he continued,
"The address is under the name of Muriel Emerson."
"Wife?"
"Hang on, let me see if I can find the tax assessment. There it is. She's his mother. Frank Jr. has a white Dodge pickup truck from 2005, a double wide, and a small boat on a trailer, according to tax records. The property is on 10 acres with a main house that's a little over 2,100 square feet, with two outbuildings. It was originally purchased by a Frank and Muriel Emerson."
Duncan opened another browser window. Flip to Google Maps. I want to see it in Street View. The surrounding woods obscured the street view, so Duncan clicked on the satellite view. A long driveway and a farmhouse appeared on the screen.
I see several sheds, a trailer, and a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.